When the sky is clear can mean only one thing. I have to get home to you before it gets too late. Because I know what's to come and you'll be there waiting for me. When there's not a cloud around, I need to be with you after the sun goes down. On a moonlit night, I love to hold you near. On a moonlit night, it's all so clear. I don't need anything but you to make everything right. On a thought of our love is so deep, it feels so whole. And in your eyes I see the warmth and the fire from when we first met. And the sight of the moon takes us to a place we will never forget. On a moonlit night, I love to hold. On a moonlit night, it's all so clear. I don't need anything but you to make everything right. On a
good morning. Welcome to Unity Spiritual Center Denver. That was the amazing Bettman and Halpin, Stephanie Bettman and Luke Halpin, and their beautiful harmonies. And you'll get to hear some more of them as we move through our service today. So welcome. Thank you for joining us this morning. Or if you're not watching this on Sunday morning, welcome wherever you are and whenever you're watching this service. We're so glad that you chose to be a part of this service today. And my name is David Howard. I have the privilege of serving as the senior minister here at Unity Spiritual Center Denver. I want you to know that our center is a loving, welcoming, inclusive community. And one day soon, I hope that we will open our doors and invite you in to feel the warmth of this community. But until then, I invite you to say with me our creed that is so important to us here at this center. Let us say together, our God is love, our race is human, our faith is oneness. And so today I have just a really short reading. It's actually a quote that I want to share with you this morning from the French Jesuit priest, philosopher, and paleontologist, Pierre Teilhard de Chardin. And he said this: "Someday, after mastering the winds, the waves, the tides, and gravity, we shall harness for God the energies of love. And then, for the second time in the history of the world, man will have discovered fire." So I invite you to join me as we sing "Surely the Presence" as a lead-in to our time of prayer.
Surely the presence of love is in this place. I can feel the mighty power and the grace. There's a holy hush around us. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of love is in this place.
So I invite you, if you're in a place where it's comfortable for you to do so, to just close your eyes. We close our outer eyes as a symbol of shutting out the world, at least for a time, and going into that sacred place, the secret chamber of our own heart, as our brother and Jesus said. And so we breathe deeply, all of our awareness into our heart space, into that chamber where we come into the conscious awareness of that divine life, the life of God, the life of love, that is living in this moment, that is having its life in and through and as each of us. And as we center our awareness there, we feel that presence. We feel that presence alive in every aspect of our being, every cell of our bodies. We feel that presence inspiring our minds, opening our hearts. We feel the connection of that presence with each other. Those who are here in this time, gathered together in many different places, but gathered together in one consciousness of one mind and one heart, to know the truth, to come together, and to remember that truth. And as we remember that truth for ourselves, we know it for each other, we know it for all humanity. Indeed, all creation is the expression of that one power, that one presence that we often call love. And in that love, as that love expressing together, we hold in our hearts all of those who are affected or have been affected and being affected by the fires that are raging around our state, that so many have fled from their homes for their safety. And we hold them in our hearts, we hold them in our minds, we hold their highest and best good, and we hold all of those who are responding, those who are there to help and to aid, and those who are fighting the fires, and those who are there on the front lines, and we hold them in our hearts as well. We see them divinely guided, surrounded in love and light, and we are grateful for their service. We are grateful for the knowing that God, love, is right there in the midst of all that is happening. And we are grateful for that knowing. We are grateful for our opportunity to express that love and share that love through our hearts and through our minds. We know this truth. We know that love is the reality, is the truth of all, and in that we are comforted, we find peace and rest, and we know that we are that love expressing. We know this truth, we claim this truth, we allow this truth to be as we accept it and allow it to become so it is. Amen.
I went up to the mountain because you asked me to. Up over the clouds to where the sky was blue. I could see you all around. Everywhere I could see all around me. Everywhere. Sometimes I feel like I've never been nothing but tired. I go on again because you asked me to. Sometimes I look down, afraid I will fall. And though the sun shines, I see nothing. And then go telling me softly, you love me so. The peaceful valley just over the mountain, the peaceful.
So thank you once again, Stephanie and Luke. Such a beautiful song by Patty Griffin, and you guys did such an amazing rendition of that song, just truly moving, and thank you for sharing that with us this morning. So first of all, I want to say I'm glad to be back. It was a nice vacation, a couple of weeks traveling out to San Diego and back, and having opportunity to hike in the mountains there and go to the beach in the very same day. That was pretty fun and amazing and a good time just to rejuvenate and to connect, reconnect. So I was glad to have that time, and I was glad to be away, and I'm so glad to be back. So I want to say thank you, first of all, to J.D. Martin and Jan Garrett for their music and message, the heart of harmony that they provided for us a couple of weeks ago. We were so blessed to have them with us. And of course, last week, I want to say thank you to our associate minister, Trish Morris, for her beautiful talk last week that was inspiring. I listened to it on my drive back, and I was certainly moved and inspired by that. If you haven't had the opportunity to watch it or to listen to it, I highly recommend that you do. You can watch it on our Facebook page, Unity Spiritual Center Denver Facebook page, or on our YouTube channel. In fact, you can watch all of our past services either place. And so, but I invite you to especially listen to that talk that Trish presented last week. She talked about this divine idea of oneness and how we are here to live that divine idea. And she talked about how that is a divine idea in the absolute, in the mind of God, in the heart of God, in the unmanifested realm. There is this divine idea that we are to bring forth into demonstration, into manifestation. It is that we are here in this realm to truly connect with the mind of God, with the heart of God, with all of these divine ideas that are our birthright as expressions of that divine life. And we are to connect with those and to bring those into demonstration. And sometimes we do that really well, and sometimes we're learning. We're always sort of balancing, as Trish said, we're balancing between the absolute and the relative. That is, as if we are have a foot in both worlds, and we are, we do. We are balancing. We are always in that place of, I'm in the awareness of these divine ideas and my connection with God, with the source of all that is, and I'm living in this human realm where I am doing my best to bring that forth. So we're bringing forth these divine ideas. And as I said, sometimes we connect with them and we bring them into manifestation and we realize, oh, well, maybe that's not quite it. Maybe it's not showing up quite in alignment with that perfection, the idea of truth with a capital T and perfection. And so we take time to go back into our connection through prayer and meditation and contemplation and all of those spiritual practices that help us to consciously connect our minds with the mind of God and our hearts with the heart of God. And then again, we do our best to bring those ideas into manifestation. It truly is our opportunity. Every moment is our opportunity to bring the consciousness of heaven, which is the consciousness of God and truth and good, our consciousness, to bring that into demonstration. And as spiritually aware and awakened and awakening people, we know that. We know that that is why we're here, and we're always doing that divine dance to bring that into manifestation to the best of our ability. And so Trish talked about that last week, as oneness as this divine idea. And so I want to build on that idea, using that idea that in this absolute realm, there are these ideas. And as we align to these ideas and these energy and this consciousness and the frequency of those ideas, that we then can demonstrate them in the world in which we live. And one of those divine ideas that I want to talk about today is the idea of love. And I know love, sometimes that word gets used in many different ways. And I'm not talking about necessarily romantic love or some idea of a relationship with another person. I'm talking about a divine idea of love. And I know that it's difficult sometimes to have words to really express what love is. So, and I know that metaphor is really The only language we have to talk about the ineffable, to talk about God, the divine. So the metaphor that I like to use for love is the sun. And the sun in our solar system, you know, the sun is always shining its light, always giving its light. And the light from the sun upon the earth, upon us, nourishes us. It feeds us. It warms us. It is always there present. And it is always giving itself to us. Sometimes it's clouded over. Sometimes we don't see it, but that doesn't mean it's not always there. And without the sun, there would be no life on this planet. And so when I think about love and I think about God or Source as the sun, that love is that energy that emanates constantly and consistently from that Source. And it is always shining out, it is always giving itself. And it is the source of life. It is the source of life for us, a source of life upon the planet. It warms us, it feeds us. It is the energy that connects us, that we are all a part of. We may not be able to see it. We may not even be able to have a mental concept of what it is in its totality, but we can experience it. We can feel it. We can surrender into it. And then we can bring it forth at whatever level we can align to it and embody it. And again, that is why we're here, is to bring that forth into the world, to truly be the presence of this energy of love in the world. And so, as I talk about that, and I've thought about that this week, I want to share with you some of the ideas I have about that, and how I want to share it with you is that in three phases, or three ideas about love, that we surrender to love, first of all. We surrender to love, and we serve love, and we stand in love, and we stand for love. And when I talk about surrendering to love, it really is about inviting the energy of love to be our point of focus, to be our point of awareness, to mentally invite love, move through me, allow me to be in alignment with love. I am now in alignment, in attunement with this divine energy of love. I want to share with you this rewrite or version of the Lord's Prayer that came to me actually today as I was meditating, as a way of inviting and affirming and attuning to that energy of love. And it is in this moment, I open my mind and my heart to the revelation and the realization of the absolute love of God. I am a willing vessel through which this love is made manifest upon the earth. All I need is provided in every moment. Each moment is an opportunity to once again choose love. I release all judgments and misperceptions of myself and others. I see all through the eyes of love. Even though I may be tempted, I will not be moved from my decision for love. I deny the reality of evil. I know that love is the only power and the only eternal reality in the universe, now and forever. So be it. Amen. It is a decision. It is a choice to surrender everything else and allow love to transform us. Allow this energy of love, as I said, you may not be able to see it. You may not even have a mental concept of it, and it doesn't matter. But when you invite it, when you open to it, when you affirm it and declare it, trust that love is here present. Love is here to move us into that place of communion and surrender. And also that we have the opportunity to serve love. You know, Jesus is quoted in Luke chapter 10. When the lawyer came to Jesus and he was trying to trip him up, and he asked Jesus, "What is the greatest commandment?" And Jesus said, "The greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul. And the second is like unto it, love your neighbor as yourself." We're all familiar with that scripture. But in the Gospel of Luke, the story doesn't stop there, because the lawyer then says, "Oh, but who is my neighbor?" And Jesus answers that question with a parable. And we know the parable as well, many of us do, is the parable of the Good Samaritan, where someone has robbed this man, and he's on the side of the street bleeding and probably dying, and the priest comes along and he just walks right by without any notice. A Levite comes along and he goes over to the other side of the street so he doesn't have to engage. Then a Samaritan comes along, and it's the Samaritan who ministers to this man who has been hurt. And not only that, but then he takes him to an inn and pays for his care and his treatment. The interesting thing about that story is that Jesus was talking to Jews. And Jews and Samaritans had nothing to do with each other. In fact, as far as the Jews were concerned, the Samaritans were the disenfranchised, the disinherited, the discounted ones. They were not important. But see, what Jesus was saying is that our neighbor is anyone. Our neighbor is anyone who needs our help. Anyone that we can serve through this energy of love. It doesn't matter whether that person is in your particular tribe, however you describe your tribe. Your tribe may be your religion. Your tribe may be your nationality. Your tribe may be your particular spiritual community. Your tribe may be, however you define that, your family, those who are in the same socioeconomic status as you. Jesus was making the distinction that our neighbor is anyone who needs our help. And so when Jesus said, "Love your neighbor," he didn't mean just the people who you would normally associate with, or the people that you think are worthy of your help. Jesus said, "Everybody is our neighbor, everybody is our brother, everybody is our sister." And if we are to serve love, if we are truly to be in that place of love, we are called, if we truly believe ourselves to be spiritually awakened and awakening people, we are called through love, through the power of love, to serve others and to help them meet whatever their needs may be in the moment. Jesus also said this in John 15, 13. He says, "No one has greater love than this, to lay down his life for his friends." Now, maybe Jesus was talking specifically to his disciples about his impending death. Literally, he was saying, "No greater love could I have for you than to lay down my life." But what we know about Jesus' teaching is that he was always teaching on different levels. He was teaching on the literal level very often, but he was also teaching more at a deeper level. So when I read that at a deeper level, what I hear is that Jesus is saying, not necessarily your physical life. You don't have to lay down your life. You don't have to die in the physical form to show your love for your friends, for your neighbors, for the people. I think what he might have been saying is that to truly love, that we may want to look at what we value, how we identify and define our lives, that we may, as Paul said, die daily to our ego attachments or to the things that we believe to be so valuable, the things that we hold on to that might keep us from truly serving the world, truly serving those who are in need of our help and our love. You know, I think about Jesus in the garden, I'm not in the garden, Jesus in the wilderness when he was tempted. And what were the temptations that he experienced in the wilderness? I think he was tempted by power. He was tempted by position. He was tempted by prestige. And I believe what that examples for us is that those are human temptations. That many of us, if not all of us, are tempted by those things. That we're tempted for power, to have power in the world. We're tempted to have this position of prestige. We're tempted to have a position of authority, or in some way of a position that others would admire. And we're tempted by that. But I think what Jesus is saying is sometimes if we are to truly serve and to love, we have the opportunity to lay that down. What is more important to us? Is power and money more important to us than love? Is our position in society or in our particular tribe more important to us than love? What do we really value? And that's a question that we get to ask ourselves. Is privilege, however we enjoy that privilege, more important to us than love? Than serving all of humanity, our friends, our neighbors? That's something that we get to ask ourselves, something I get to ask myself. Because I recognized on this trip that I was on these past 2 weeks, many things, but one thing is I recognized how truly privileged I am. How truly privileged and what a privileged life I live. Just the fact that I could get away, that I could separate myself for a time from my daily activities, from my daily life, is a privilege that many people do not enjoy. Not that I am shaming myself or want to feel guilty about that. It was just a recognition. And it helped me to really more appreciate my life and my privilege. But am I willing? Am I willing to even dare to wonder? Am I willing to give up my privilege in order to be love in the world and to serve others? I think that's a question that I want to invite us into, to explore that for ourselves. And then lastly, I want to talk about standing in love and standing for love. In Matthew 7:12, Jesus says, "So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you, for this sums up the law and the prophets." This is it. This is the culmination of it all. To do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And that is a way that we stand in love and the way that we serve love in the world. What does that mean for us? You know, there are many things in the world today that call to us, I believe, to love. There are many things happening in the world around us today that I dare say that many of us would love to see different. We would like to change some of the things that are going on in the world today. And very often, I think what we try to do is we try to maneuver the things on the external. We try to change it from the external. And sometimes we try to change those things and we try to affect change from a place where we're not necessarily connected in love, where we're trying and we're maybe even a fearful place. And so what are we doing? But we're creating more from a fearful place. I think it's so important for us to stand in love first. To stand in the power of love and bring love to whatever we do. But I believe that standing in love is also about standing up for love. And standing in solidarity and love with our brothers and our sisters and our friends and our neighbors that Jesus talked about, all of humanity. To stand in love sometimes requires of us to speak out for love. To stand in love sometimes requires us to speak and to call out and to call up situations that are not reflective of love. Standing in love, I believe, requires us sometimes to stand for and with those people who are demonstrating love, who are living love in their own lives, those who are supporting the people who may be the disenfranchised and the discounted and the disinherited in the world around us, those who do not enjoy the power and the privilege and the prestige and the position that so many of us do get to enjoy. And I will say this, that I believe standing in love asks us to stand for love as we choose who will be our leaders, who will be the leaders in our political environment, who will be our leaders in our spiritual family, who will be our leaders, who will be the leaders of this country. To stand with and for those who embody the energy of love and compassion and empathy and kindness. Those who exhibit those qualities that we so value. Those who are truly, to whatever capacity they are able, truly exhibiting love. And not fear, not division, not separation. And I hesitate to talk about that, but I'm not telling you how to vote, who to vote for. That is not my position. But I want to encourage us all of us, to stand in love, to embody love, and to connect with those who are, to whatever capacity, living love and embodying love. And as Trish said last week, to truly stand for, to stand up for policies that are expressions of love for all of humanity and for the environment and for the earth. And if we truly believe in this divine idea of love, if we truly are intentional about surrendering to love and serving love and standing in love, don't we want to see love exhibited in the world? Don't we want to stand for love in the world? And that love, as Jesus, our teacher, our way shower, our elder brother, said to us, is to care for, to protect, to minister to all of humanity, and indeed all of creation. And so we're doing our best. As I said at the beginning, to connect with this energy, this divine idea of love, in this absolute idea, and then to bring it forth into demonstration, into manifestation. Because we are here, my friends, my family, to truly bring that into demonstration upon the earth. I believe that's why we're here. And I believe that love is the only power. Love is the only reality. Love is the only thing that will ever transform the world. And it truly is up to you and me to be the expression of love in the world, to stand with our brothers and sisters, to stand with those organizations, the people who are truly living the energy of love, and to speak up, to speak out from love in every way that we possibly can. Because I know you join with me, I know you do, in wanting to see a world transformed by love and embodying love. So let's take just a moment or two to breathe into that. Breathe into the idea, the consciousness of love. Just close your eyes if you're in a place where you can do that comfortably and safely. Take a deep breath. Allow that breath to bring all of your awareness from the thinking mind deep into the heart. Into the heart of love, into the heart of God, right here, right now, present. And allow everything else, if you can, just to fall away in that commitment, in that intention to surrender. To surrender it all to love and to invite love to transform your mind, to transform your doubt and your fear. Allow love to be your guiding light, your guiding principle, inviting it, welcoming it, declaring it here and now. And as you breathe, feel that energy of love coming alive deep within you, deep in your heart. Feel it opening your heart. And as your heart is open, allow that love to flow out into the world, touching lives, touching hearts, opening minds. Know that you are a radiating center of love right here and right now. And feel that energy of love moving all the way down through the bottom of your feet, grounding you here and now. Standing firm in love as love, expressing in this moment. Bringing that energy of love into this dimension. You are a vessel, you're a channel, you're an open conduit for love in this moment. And know that that love shines brightly. And know that love is the truth, is the only power. Allow that love to do its perfect work in you, through you, as you. I invite you now just to raise your hands and palms pointed outward and just imagine that love flowing through your heart, down your arms and out through your hands, radiating out through your palms, blessing the world. Allowing that love to be drawn to any situation, any person, any area of the world. Know that you are love expressing in this moment. And as we go into a time of silence, I invite you to be with that and allow that energy of love to be drawn through you to bless the world in whatever way calls to you. Together we see this entire planet enfolded in the vibration of love. Love touching every heart and every mind. Love healing. Love bringing together. Love attracting. Love as this energy that connects us all. And breathe that energy back into your own heart. feeling that love radiating throughout your body, through your mind, through your heart. Feel yourself embraced in love. And take a deep breath as we bring our attention back into this time and space. Feel your feet grounded in love, bringing love into the here and now. In this moment, in this place, I remember who I am, letting fear and worry fall away from me. Open my eyes and see. There is only love. There is only love. Love that heals. Love that sets us free. There is only There is only love. There is only love. Love that heals. Love that sets us free. There is only Take a deep breath, coming fully back into this time and space. And so now is our time when we have the opportunity to express our love for this community and for the ministry here at Unity Spiritual Center Denver. And so on your screen, there are options of ways for you to contribute. I want to say thank you to all of those who continue to support this ministry. We are so blessed, truly blessed, by your commitment. And if this is your first time giving to this ministry, thank you as well. We appreciate your donation and your contribution to us. So now let us say our offertory blessing together. Divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I am, all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. I am thankful.
I am standing on the side of love, standing on the side of love, and I am walking hand in hand with love, walking hand in hand with love. I am standing on the side. Sometimes I fall, but it don't matter. No, not at all. I am standing straight and proud and tall, standing on the side of love. And I am standing on the side of love. Standing on the side of love. And I am walking hand in hand with love. Walking hand in hand with love. I am standing on the side.
Thank you once again, Stephanie and Luke. We are so glad to have you with us. What a great song. Thank you for sharing that, and so beautifully appropriate for the talk today. Thank you so much. So we will have fellowship today after service, actually at 11:30 on Zoom. We invite you to join us there. The link will be posted here in the comments section right here on Facebook and on YouTube. So if you're looking for the link, find it there. And next Saturday, we will have a pumpkin painting party outside for our children and families. So if you are a family with children and would like to participate in that event, please contact Natalie in our Youth and Family Ministry department. And thank you once again for joining us today. So I invite you now to say our closing prayer with me. The light of God surrounds us. I am the light of God. The love of God enfolds us. I am the love of God. The power of God protects us. I am the power of God. The presence of God watches over us. I am the presence of God. Wherever we are, God is, and so it is. And now, let's close by singing Love Can Move the World. Love can move the world as the moon in the sky moves the sea. Love can cause the wars to cease. Love can move this world to peace. It's a tide that begins with you and me. Love can move the world as the warmth of the sun moves the trees. Feel the winds of love increase as we move this world to peace. Come, love the world with me. Come.